Amen. Here in the power of the risen Christ, we stand.
Come on.
What a joy it is to be with you on Easter morning. Welcome to St. John's with St. Mary's. Welcome to those of you who are online. Welcome to whether you've been to this church or not before. You are so welcome. It is so great to see you. We're so excited to rejoice with you this Easter day.
And before you sit down, we've got a response that we'd love you to join us in. So that's going to come up on the screen. Just a way of us all, and you can be as loud as you like for this. So get ready for this. If you need to cover your ears, go for it. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Once more, the Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Brilliant. Do you want to take a seat?
It is such a joy to be with you in person. I was just realizing that Chris has been vicar, I've been married to him for longer than 2 years, but Chris has been the vicar here for the last 2 years, but this is the first time we've gathered on an Easter day. Oh, it's making me all emotional. To celebrate Easter day together, sorry.
So we can celebrate today with like triple the enthusiasm because we've got two that we didn't celebrate properly to make up for. Is
absolutely
that right?
Yeah. Something like
great.
That, yes.
Amazing.
Before we officially properly start rejoicing, we've got a couple of notices.
We have. If you're new today or haven't joined us before or would just like to get more involved in the life of the church, we've got these cards at the back. You might be able to find someone, a friendly looking face with a lanyard on. They'll be part of the welcome team and they'll help you fill in one of these cards if you want to be part of our mailing list to find out more things that are going on and just join in more. And so there's kind of a section at the bottom where you can say, hey, I'd like to find more out about this, or I'd like you to pray for this. So if you're kind of new or newish, do think about getting one of these filled out. And the second thing that I need to say is, if this party is really exciting for you, that what we do today, the party doesn't have to end, because next week at 3 o'clock, we're going to have our APCM. Woo! That's a chance for us to celebrate the year that we've had, because even though there have been difficulties, there have been some amazing things that we can celebrate together. We can look forward to the new thing, and we can vote in people to be part of the leadership of the church and pray for them. So it's a really great time to gather. I think there'll probably be food. There'll certainly be worship and prayer. So do join us here at 3 o'clock if you're interested in being part of continuing this party.
I love how well you're selling that.
I sold it as best I could.
Let's make the annual church meeting the best, most fun, enjoyable thing that we can.
Yeah.
And we've done it again. I haven't introduced myself. My name is Ruth. I'm married to Chris. Chris is the vicar here. I also have, there's more to me than just married to the vicar. I always get told off for just saying that. But in terms of context, that's who I am. And we're going to be leading the service together. We are being led in worship by a wonderful band. Thank you so much. We've got the tech team at the back who are brilliant, the welcome team. We've got refreshments later, and I think I saw some chocolate cupcakes, which I'm very excited about.
Yes.
So yes, you are welcome. Anything else that I need to say?
I don't know. Should we check the plan?
Yes.
Great.
Happy Easter. Indeed.
Brilliant. I think that's it. Shall we stand and sing?
Let's stand and sing together.
Hidden glory in creation.
Lord of all life and power, who through the mighty resurrection of your Son overcame the old order of sin and death to make all things new in him. Grant that we, being dead to sin and alive to you in Jesus Christ, may reign with him in glory, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be praise and honor, glory and might, now and in all eternity. Amen. Do you want to take a seat? We're going to have our Bible reading now, and it's going to be brought to you by some fantastic actors who have had a lot of rehearsal for this. So I'm going to be off stage narrating it, but just so you know where we're up to in the story, on Friday, we celebrated the events of Good Friday, of Jesus' death on the cross. And after he died, he was taken down and put in a borrowed tomb. And the stone was rolled across the entranceway. And there he stayed throughout the whole of Saturday, because it was a day of rest for the Jewish people, so no one could do any work. And we pick up our story early on Sunday morning. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices that they had prepared and went to the tomb. There they found the stone rolled away from the tomb.
Wait, what? We're in the right place. Where is it?
When they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus.
Where did he go? This is the right one, right?
While they were still wondering about this, suddenly, two people in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the angel said to them, the angel continued to remind them how he told them while he was still with them in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again. Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But the apostles did not believe the women because their words seemed like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves. And he went away, wondering what had happened. Now we're going to pause it there, because it's time for a bit of a rewind. Because I think we can't get the full power of this moment unless we've got reminded ourselves of the backstory of how we got here. So we're going to rewind, and this is the rewinding action. Okay, so if you could all join me in doing the rewind action, and we're going to rewind a few days to the night before Jesus died. See what I did there? Because we're going to share communion together, and that remembers the night before Jesus died. And when Jesus was on that night, that Thursday night, he gathered his friends to him, just like we're gathered today. And among his friends included Judas, who was going to betray Jesus. It included Peter, who was going to deny Jesus. And today, among us, it includes all of us who have done things wrong, who have let God down, who haven't lived up to the amazing message that Jesus came to bring. So we're just going to spend just a moment in quiet, You might want to close your eyes as you just bring before God those times when you feel like you've let him down, as we ask for his forgiveness. Lord God, we're sorry for the times when we've done things wrong, for the times we've let you down, for the times when we've failed to do the good things that you've prepared for us to do. We want to turn away from those times and turn towards you, and we ask you to give us a fresh start. We ask for your forgiveness to be upon us. In Jesus' name, amen. And so may God, who loves you so much, forgive your sins, give you a fresh start and new life with Jesus. Amen. The other thing that Jesus did on that night with his disciples was he prayed. And he prayed for himself and his mission. He prayed for his friends. And he prayed for the whole world. And as part of that, he prayed these words. He prayed, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." Jesus prayed that we might have peace through what he was doing. And so I get to declare to you today, the peace of the Lord be with you. Brilliant. Some people were paying attention to the words on the screen. That was excellent. Do you want to just turn around and see if you can wave at about 10 people and say, "Peace be with you," to them? And in case you're worried that we're doing things in a strange order today, it just seemed like it made sense with the story. So it's not that you've missed the sermon and you dozed off and I did it while you're asleep. It's still coming, so don't worry. But I just thought it'd be great for us to share communion and to remember together what Jesus has done for us. So there's going to be some words that come up on the screen. And if we could all join in with the ones that are in bold. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is always right, wherever we are, to give you thanks and praise. God our Father, you are holy and strong, King forever. Through your Son, you made us and the whole universe. Your Holy Spirit came to Mary, and Jesus was born as one of us. When his time had come, Jesus suffered and died on the cross. But on the third day, you raised him from the dead and crowned him Lord of all. You send your Spirit to bring new life to the world and fill us with power from on high. And so we join on earth with saints and angels in heaven to praise your name and say, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest." Father, on the night before he died, Jesus had a meal with his friends. He took the bread and he thanked you. He broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take this and eat it. This is my body given for you." After the meal, Jesus took the cup of wine. He thanked you, gave it to them and said, "This is my blood, the new covenant of God's love. Do this to remember me." Jesus Christ has died. Jesus Christ is risen. Jesus Christ will come again. Father, as we remember his death and resurrection, send your Holy Spirit that these gifts of bread and wine we bring before you may be for us Christ's body and blood. Pour your Spirit on each one of us, that we may live as children of your heavenly kingdom. Help us to love one another as we work for the peace of the earth and wait for Jesus to come in glory. For all honor and glory belong to you, Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, with the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. And we're going to pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. We've got actions for this, so if you know those, do join in with those. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of Christ. That's the night before Jesus died, which means that now we're on to the day that Jesus died, Good Friday. And so we turn our attention to the cross. And I just want to kind of stay at that point for a moment before we go zip on to Resurrection Sunday. And I want to ask you, what would you, if someone were to ask you to draw love, I wonder what you would draw. Perhaps it, as an easier thing, if I were to ask you what shape would you draw for love? Can anyone show me what you would draw? If you wanted to draw love, what would you draw? Brilliant. Loads of people are doing that kind of action, making a heart shape. Okay, I want to say today, I think maybe that's the wrong shape to stand for love. I think there is a shape that stands for love that is greater than that one, and it's this one, the cross. Okay, not just because it looks like your arms are spread wide, ready for a hug, but because it represents the cross. And the Bible tells us that the cross is the greatest example of love that we can ever show. Because you see, love is about sacrifice. Love is about perhaps giving up something that we might want for the good of someone else. We put someone else's needs before our own. And the ultimate example of that would be being willing to die for someone else. And that's what Jesus did for us. Even before we knew him, he was willing. He loved us so much that he was willing to be killed for our sake. He was willing to die for us. That's pretty amazing, I think. And the Bible says this is how we know what love is, that Jesus gave his life for us. So I think the cross is the ultimate shape of love. I think that's really key to understanding what we're about. That's why we have the symbol of the cross in all our churches. I think it brings to mind this, if we're talking about this question of love, perhaps you've sometimes wondered, well, does God even love me? Could God love someone like me? Or perhaps you've thought, I wonder how much God loves me. And it says in the Bible that God loved the world so much that he gave his only son. Not just you and me. He loved every single person in the world. But also that includes you and me. So that if you were the only person in the world, God would still have loved you enough to send his only son to die for you. But God does love the whole world. And he calls us to join with him in loving the whole world. That we follow that way of the cross and that we become part of showing his love to the world. So he gave his only son. And the reason he gave his only son, it says in John 3:16, is that we would not die, but live forever, but have everlasting life with him. I think that's pretty amazing. He didn't just die to give us a little bit of extension on life. He didn't die to stop us dying to one specific thing. He died to take away death from us, so that we don't need to be afraid of what comes after death, because he has told us it's everlasting life. So how much does God love us? How much does God love you? He loves you enough to die for you. How much does God love you? This much. That's how much God loves you. This much. So that's what the symbol of love. We've got a song that we kind of showed you at the end of our service last time. We've been practicing it with some of the kids as well. So hopefully some of them will know it and be able to join in the actions. We've got actions for this song. And it's a song that is sung kind of from the perspective of God. It's as if God is saying these things over us. And it says, if you want to know how far my love will go, just how deep, just how wide, if you want to see how much you mean to me, look at my hands, look at my side. If you could count the times I'd say you are forgiven, it's more than the drops in the ocean. Okay? Do you want to have a go at that? Shall we sing this together? Let's stand up. Do you want to join in the actions if you can?
It breaks my heart to see you suffering, 'cause I am for you. I'm not against you. If you want.
So I hope you hear that today and know that God is for you and that he loves you so much. We're going to sing again. The band are going to lead us in a song that helps us again to focus on the cross. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died. Let's sing together.
Glory died. My
Would you like to take a seat? Because it doesn't end at the cross, does it? We've already heard the story of what happens next on that Easter Sunday morning, early when the women go to the tomb. Jesus doesn't stay on the cross. There's a reason in church that we don't tend to depict Jesus on our cross, on a cross in our buildings. That's why the cross is empty, because Jesus is not there. Jesus no longer hangs on that symbol of death. And the women came to the tomb expecting to find his body so that they could honor him for what he'd done for them. But as they got to the tomb, he wasn't there. So where is Jesus? Well, to start with, I want to confirm for you that he is definitely not in the grave. You see, in Jerusalem, they've built a big cathedral over the place where Jesus' body lay. And in the middle of that cathedral, there's a small chapel. And in that small chapel is where the tomb was. And I queued up one day for quite a lot of minutes. The queue stretched all the way around the building. And I queued up in this amazing cathedral. And when we finally got to go in, I stooped in and went in. Guess what was in there? Nothing! I queued up all that time and there was nothing there. So I can tell you, Jesus is not there. He was not in his grave. He's not there. And do you know what? As I was reflecting on it, it was kind of almost like this whole building was set up to try and capture that moment, to like try and capture the essence of Jesus in this little building inside a much grander, bigger building. And I thought, I think they've missed the point. I think they've missed the boat. He's already gone. You were too late to build this thing around him, because he's not there anymore. He's left. He's alive. He's risen. It's like they wanted to kind of contain his power, the power of Jesus, the power of God in human flesh. They wanted to try and contain that in that place, but they can't, because it's too powerful. It broke the power of the grave and it spread out into all the world. I think that's the amazing news about Easter, that Jesus can't be contained, not by death, not by a building. His power is out there in the world and it's changing things. It's making things new. It's changing us and making us new too. Jesus is not here. He's here. He is alive. And he still prays for us like he did at that Last Supper with his disciples. He still talks to God on our behalf. He still speaks in the ear of his Father to say to God, I want to pray for this person. I want to pray for Chris. I want to pray for Jake. I want to pray for Ruth. I want to pray for all of these people. I want to pray for Mansfield. I want to pray for the UK. I want to pray for Ukraine. Jesus still prays for us and on our behalf. And also what it means, because he's not in the tomb, he's not dead, we can still be friends with him. We can be his friends. He's left that as an offer open on the table for us. Not only has he made it possible for us to know God and call God our Father, but we can call Jesus our friend. That's pretty amazing. Jesus is with us and he wants to be our friend. And he's broken the power of death and made it possible for us to live with him forever. That's what Jesus has done for us. That's what the empty tomb means to us. It's a sign of hope. It's no longer just a grave. It's a sign of life, of new life that we get through Jesus. It's the greatest good news we could ever have delivered. And it was delivered on that Sunday morning by a few women who went to the tomb early. And it was delivered to the disciples. And do you remember what the disciples' response was at first? They thought they were talking nonsense because it's too good to be true. The idea that that Jesus has broken the power of death, that he's overcome it, that he's alive and that his power is at work in all the world. But I guess that leaves us to come to our own response, doesn't it? Because we hear this message And my question to you today is, will you come and see? We're gonna have two songs in a moment, and we'd love you to come. And I realize this is symbolic, and this isn't actually Jesus' tomb. But as an act of symbolism, would you like to come and look into the tomb and see for yourself that Jesus is not there? He has risen. And we're going to have these. We've got a whole load of, they're not actual grave clothes. We've got a whole load of strips of cloth which are standing in for our grave clothes. And we'd love you to take one of those away with you. You might want to write on it, if you've got a pen in your pew, you might want to write on it or draw on it a situation or a person that you want to see Jesus' power at work in. That power that was strong enough to break open death. Where would you like to see that power working? That's going to be the way we pray. So we're kind of going to be praying as well as singing in this bit. But I'd love to encourage you to come and take a piece of these grave clothes away with you to remember Jesus is risen. His power is out there and at work in the world. So come and see. It's not nonsense. This is true. Jesus rose from the dead. That's amazing. Amen. We're going to sing. Feel free, as God leads you, to come up to look in the tomb and to take some grave clothes away with you to pray with.
Happy day, I'll never be the same.
Amen. We're coming towards the end of our service. If you would like prayer, perhaps even because you're still puzzled over this announcement of good news like the disciples were, and you just want someone to talk more about it and pray about it with you, then we've got this space down here after the service. You're welcome to come and be prayed for. Or if perhaps you've just heard about Jesus risen from the tomb, defeating the power of death, and that stirred something in you, and you just want to pray, God, I want to know Jesus more. I want Jesus' power to live within me. Then do come up, and we'll pray with you there. But I'd love us, I've got a final prayer for us to pray. Let's pray this together. Father God, thank you for giving us your only Son, Jesus Christ, so that we might not die but have eternal life. We have shared in his body and blood. Now, as we go from here, may we share his life with the world and live as your new creation. Amen. And may the power of the risen Lord Jesus live in you and be at work in your life today and every day. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and those you love, now and always. Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.
One more time.